Hi, I'm Bob Sharits, and I am the program director for the Way Out Recovery, and I've also been a drug and alcohol treatment provider for about the last 15 years. I'm here today because I want to convey a message, a very important, maybe the most important message, and that is a message about impaired driving. When I talk about impaired driving, I'm not If you hear the terms drunk driving or driving under the influence, those are all the same things. Any driving or using any kind of machinery while under the influence of any mind or mood altering substance, such as alcohol, prescription medications, marijuana, or any other illicit drugs, driving under the influence of those can be extremely dangerous and can not only put your life in jeopardy, but also the lives of others. We have a message today from Jacob Evans. Jacob Evans was tragically left with 6 children to raise on his own after his wife, Katie Evans, was killed by a drunk driver and suddenly taken out of their lives. And so Jacob has come today to give us a message about how that has impacted his life, how it has impacted the lives of his children, and how it will continue to impact everything that he and his children do because of the decision of one person to get behind the wheel while under the influence of alcohol.
My name's Jacob Evans, and my wife was killed by a drunk driver right here in Santa Clarita Valley. I want to share my story because I want people to understand just how devastating it is when something like this happens. It completely ruined my life to that point, and you know, there have been some good things that have happened since, but I don't want anyone to have to go through the sort of suffering and pain that my family's gone through, so I want a chance to share my story. Yeah, so Katie was amazing. She was the sort of person who, just by being in her presence, you felt better. She just made everything seem better. And she'd light up a room when she was in there. She just had a very light sort of feel to her. And that didn't mean she couldn't take things seriously. You know, she'd been through some challenging situations in her life, but, you know, she chose to have a really optimistic attitude toward things. And also, she was very caring, very loving. And she was always the first one to comfort someone who was going through something difficult. And so, you know, for me, it was kind of a double whammy when I lost her, because in the moment I needed her the most, because I just, you know, lost my best friend, she wasn't there to help. She was who I would turn to. So, you know, I really, really still miss that. You know, when I get home from work and it's been a rough day, I really miss, you know, being able to just talk to her or be there with her and everything feeling a little bit better. Katie was killed October 6th, 2017. And, you know, she was 37 years old. She was a young mom with, you know, twins that weren't even 2 months old. They'd never been home. They were still in the NICU in UCLA. She was on her way back from the hospital. So to understand what happened that night, you need to understand that the girls were in the NICU for a long period of time. And Katie was going down and visiting them every single day. She'd read studies that showed that if the mom was there present in the NICU with the girls, that they would do better, they would heal better. So she went down every single day. It was a 3-hour commute back and forth. And so, you know, I missed her, but I understood why she was down there. This particular day, we hadn't had anyone to help. So I came home from work early. And then she went down to UCLA around 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You know, I spent the day, you know, making dinner for the kids, taking them to the park, trying to put a good face on the fact that their mom wasn't around. And she called me around 11. She was a little frustrated with some of the things going on with the girls. And I told her, look, you're really tired. We've been going through a lot. Why don't you just come home? And, you know, we can deal with this tomorrow. So it's around 11 o'clock, and it's without much traffic. You know, it's about 40 minutes to get home from UCLA. So, you know, I just turned on the TV and was waiting for her. And when she hadn't gotten home by midnight, I called her, and you know, there's no answer. Didn't ring. Just went straight to voicemail. I got a little bit worried, but I thought, yeah, she probably just was a little bit late getting out. So I, you know, just try to be patient. But by 12:30, I just couldn't be patient anymore. I tried to call the hospital, see if anyone had seen her. I tried to call any place she might be. I was trying to just worry about what could have happened, especially because she'd been a little bit tired. I thought, oh, well, maybe she's stranded and she needs some help somewhere. I don't know. But then, you know, by 1 o'clock in the morning, when I hadn't heard anything, couldn't get a hold of her. I had a friend who's a policeman. I called him to ask if maybe he knew something. And, you know, long story short, you know, by about 2:30, I woke up my son and told him I was going to be back in a little bit, not to worry if he woke up and I wasn't there. And I decided to retrace my steps, or retrace her steps, her drive down to UCLA. And it was only a mile from the house where they had the whole road taped off. And, you know, they wouldn't let me through. I asked what had happened. They confirmed that there'd been a car accident, and they wouldn't tell it to me straight, but you know, I was able to put all the pieces together and figure out that unfortunately that was her right there, a mile from her house, killed by a drunk driver. So that's, you know, 2:30 in the morning, and you know, I went home. I wasn't gonna sleep, obviously. And I just thought, what am I gonna tell the kids? You know, part of me wanted to wake him up and let him know, but I thought, no, let's let him have one last good night of sleep. And so I, you know, called my bishop at church, and some other friends came over. They were there in the middle of the night, no problem. They're right away, and, you know, they stayed with me, and we made a nice breakfast for the kids, and started to call family members and let them know that you know, Katie wasn't coming home. The coroner came finally at 5:30. It took him a long time because they couldn't positively identify the body. It had been so mangled in the accident. They never even let me see the body. It was, it was really hard. You know, you want to at least be able to say goodbye, and I didn't even get that chance. So you know, I was blessed to have good family and friends around me to lift me up and support me, but anybody who thinks that, you know, drinking and driving is just something that happens to anybody else and isn't going to happen to them, you know, I'm jealous of that naive world that they can live in. But the truth is that thousands and thousands of people are killed by drunk drivers every year. It's one of the leading causes of death. Yeah, so I've never drunk alcohol a day in my life. My wife never drank alcohol a day in her life, and yet, you know, alcohol killed my wife and left me with 6 children, 3 still in diapers. Alcohol is everybody's business. You know, don't let your friends drink and drive. Don't let somebody leave a party drunk, because you never know. It might be someone you know that's life is impacted forever. It's everybody's business.